Good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to Layton Valley. It is the fifth Sunday in the season of Lent. Through Lent, we've been watching as Jesus has been going into battle against sin for us. Today's emphasis shifts to what happens to those who don't want to be a part of his side, to those who actually fight against him. That's what we're going to find out through our readings, through all three of them, kind of different aspects of that. What happens to those who aren't on the side of Jesus? And again, the encouragement is going to be for us to be with him on his side. So that's going to be our focus through today. We start on page 3 in the worship folder with our first hymn, which is hymn 382, My Hope is Built on Nothing Less. We ask God to bless you here for your worship today.
Sins.
Restore us, good Lord, and let your anger depart from us.
Hear us, Lord, for your mercy is great.
The Almighty God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, does not desire the death of sinners, but rather that they turn from their wickedness and live. Therefore, I forgive you all your sins in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. During these days of Lent, let us implore God to give us renewal and his Holy Spirit.
O Lord, my God, I call to you for help, and you answer me. I thank you for the love you have shown me in Jesus Christ, my Savior. Through him you have rescued me from the guilt of my sin, and given me the peace of forgiveness. Help me fight against temptation, correct whatever wrongs I can, and serve you and those around me with love and good works. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
In the peace of forgiveness, let us praise the Lord. It's not just thinking about things that God has done that he wants us to focus on. Yes, these are good acts, especially here referring to the Exodus, referring to bringing his people out of Egypt, out of slavery. This is a good thing. But he has something even better in store for them. Not just freedom from a physical slavery, but also a spiritual slavery. That's the new thing the Lord will do, what he wants his people to remember and to think about. You hear now from Isaiah chapter 43. This is what the Lord says. He who made a way through the sea, a path through the mighty waters, who drew out the chariots and horses, the army and reinforcements together, and they lay there, never to rise again, extinguished, snuffed out like a wick. Forget the former things. Do not dwell on the past. See, I'm doing a new thing. Now it springs up. Do you not perceive it? I'm making a way in the wilderness and streams in the wasteland. The wild animals honor me, the jackals and the owls, because I provide water in the wilderness and streams in the wasteland to give drink to my people, my chosen, the people I formed for myself, that they may proclaim my praise. This is the word of our Lord.
Today's second Bible reading comes from Romans chapter 11, reading verses 11 to 21. God teaches us through these words that it is entirely his doing when we belong to him and his people. May we give him the praise for grafting us to his root. Again I asked, did they stumble so as far beyond recovery? Not at all. Rather, because of their transgressions, salvation has come to the Gentiles to make Israel envious. But if their transgression means riches for the world, and their loss means riches for the Gentiles, how much greater riches will their full inclusion bring? I am talking to you, Gentiles, inasmuch as I am the apostle to the Gentiles. I take pride in my ministry in the hope that I may somehow arouse my own people to envy and save some of them. For if their rejection brought reconciliation to the world, what will their acceptance be but life from the dead? If the part of the dough offered as first fruits is holy, then the whole batch is holy. If the root is holy, so are the branches. If some of the branches have broken off, And you, though a wild olive shoot, have been grafted among the others and now share in the nourishing sap from the olive root. Do not consider yourself to be superior to those other branches. If you do, consider this. You do not support the root, but the root supports you. You will say then, branches were broken off so that I could be grafted in. Granted, but they were broken off because of unbelief, and you stand by faith. Do not be arrogant, but tremble, for if God did not spare the natural branches, he will not spare you either. Please stand for the reading of the gospel.
Our gospel for today comes from Luke chapter 20, verses 9 to 19. These words will serve as a basis of this morning's sermon. We hear. Jesus went on to tell the people this parable. A man planted a vineyard, rented it to some farmers, and went away for a long time. At harvest time, he sent a servant to the tenants so that they could give him some of the fruit of the vineyard. But the tenants beat him and sent him away empty-handed. He sent another servant, but that one also they beat and treated shamefully and sent away empty-handed. He sent still a third, and they wounded him and threw him out. And the owner of the vineyard said, "What shall I do? I will send my son, whom I love. Perhaps they will respect him." But when the tenants saw him, they talked the matter over. "This is the heir," they said. "Let's kill him, and the inheritance will be ours." So they threw him out of the vineyard and killed him. What then will the owner of the vineyard do to them? He will come and kill those tenants and give the vineyard to others. When the people heard this, they said, "May this never be." Jesus looked directly at them and asked, "What then is the meaning of that which is written? The stone the builders rejected has become the capstone. Everyone who falls on that stone will be broken to pieces, but he on whom it falls will be crushed." The teachers of the law, the chief priests, looked for a way to arrest him immediately because they knew he had spoken this parable against them, but they were afraid of the people. This is the gospel of our Lord.
Praise be to you, O Christ.
You may be seated. Invite the children up for a children's message. So we were talking about a capstone, a cornerstone. These are architectural terms about buildings. So a cornerstone, do you guys know what a cornerstone is? It is on a corner.
So it's a property.
It can mark property, like the one we have in the picture says. But a cornerstone, you need it to be set exactly level in the right exact spot, because every other part of the building you're going to build based on that. So if that's crooked, if it's not center, the rest of the building won't be crooked. It's also a thing, if you pull that cornerstone out, the rest of the building may crumble. So it's kind of like this. So I got these little Dixie cups. This is probably the best way I can illustrate it. You take the cornerstone out, this blue one, what do you think is going to happen? All falls down. Right? So Jesus says he is our cornerstone. Thank you, Megan. Says he's our cornerstone. That we build on him because he did everything for us. He kept every commandment in our place. Did that his whole life. And then he gave up his life on the cross to take away our sins. So we build on him. We know we have perfection because of what Jesus has done. We know that we'll go to heaven because of him. And so we always want to build on Jesus as our cornerstone and not anything else. Because anything else, what happens if I push that cornerstone out? So we keep Jesus as our cornerstone. He's everything for us. So let's pray about that. Dear Jesus, thank you for being our cornerstone, for being the one who kept all of God's commands for us, who died on the cross to take away our sins, because we know what you have done. That is our righteousness, that's our holiness, that's how we're perfect before you, and that is what we want to build on, only you as our cornerstone. In your name we pray. Amen. All right, you guys can head back to your books. Thanks for coming up here this morning. We're going to continue with our next hymn, and the next hymn is hymn 110, My Song is Love Unknown, hymn 110.
Thank you.
Grace, mercy, and peace to you from God our Father, and from our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. The portion of God's word that we're going to focus on this morning was the gospel reading we heard from Luke chapter 20. But as we give meditation on that word, let's pray. Dear Lord, as we hear your word, we hear that you are our cornerstone. You are the one who also completes us, our capstone. May we only ever, always build on you, and you would be our completeness, that we would never forsake you for anyone else. In your name we pray. Amen. Dear friends in Christ, what were those tenants thinking? I mean, where is it a good idea to take the servants of the person who owns this land, who owns this vineyard, and beat them, mistreat them, wound them, cast them out, send them away empty-handed? You are just hired hands. You don't own the land. You have no right to it. And then, when the heir apparent, the son of the owner, comes, you decide it's a good idea to kill him, because then there's no heir and we can have it all for ourselves. May this never be. For people to be so dishonest, to be so greedy, to be so murderous in their actions. May this never be. But there's more. Well, what else did they do? Well, it's the owner's reaction. The owner of the vineyard then comes and rains some righteous wrath down on these tenant farmers. And you know, they had it coming. They went and killed his beloved son. And so it just makes sense that, yep, the owner comes and he kills these tenants and gives the land, the vineyard, to others. But why? Why couldn't we found a different solution, a more peaceful way of handling this? Why so much death? Why so much violence? May this never be. Now, Jesus told this parable, this story, to get us to that point. To say, may this never be. We don't want to see any of these things that just happened actually happen. Violence begets violence. We don't want to see people die. We don't want to see people killed. We don't want to see people mistreated or hurt. And we don't want to see people being dishonest or greedy. May this never be. At the same time, the people understood what Jesus was saying. They understood this was a story, but it was a story that wasn't so hypothetical, but was actually pointing to what was going on right in front of the people. The owner is, of course, God the Father, his beloved Son, Jesus, his servants whom he had sent to his people. Those were the prophets, the people who owned the vineyard. Those were his chosen people, the Israelites, the Jewish nation. And repeatedly throughout history, when the Father sent his servants, the prophets, to his people, they were mistreated. Sometimes they were beaten, wounded. And yep, even in that very hour, they were looking for a way to arrest Jesus and to get rid of him for good. But we're not like those tenant farmers, are we? I mean, who of us would have that great idea that, hey, this land doesn't belong to us, but we work it. If we just, you know, hurt and wound and send away the servants, if we kill the son, we get it all. It's all ours. We're nothing like that, are we? Not so on the surface. It doesn't seem that way. But if you get into their motivation, it's not that difficult to understand. It's greed, pure and simple. Take something that doesn't belong to us and use it for our own personal advantage, our own personal gain. That's just at the heart of their actions. That's why they do what they do. They think that they can manipulate the situation so it can become all of their personal gain. Now, as a pastor, I can definitely see this, and maybe even to me it hits a little closer to home, because I know that the position that I've been called to can very easily be manipulated. You know, I think every single one of you here would definitely at least raise an eyebrow if you heard, oh, you know, Pastor Klein's got a mega yacht sitting out there in the Great Salt Lake. Or my wife just really struck a very good book deal. If you saw me driving a Bugatti to church, you'd be like, no. There's something wrong with that. But there is a less obvious way, but still a sinister way, that a pastor can abuse his power. He can use his people just to feel better about himself. Use his people to do his work so that he can be lazy. That he could make you feel like the only reason there's anything good is because of me. That I am God's gift to you, not the other way around. So my prayer is, God, keep me humble to recognize that the people here are your gift. My time is for you, not me. But greed, selfishness, that was the attitude of the tenant farmers. That's something we very much can find in ourselves. When it comes to our life, is it pretty much just all about me? Or is it about us? When I come to my weekends, when I look at my weekends, is it about how I get to spend my time? Or do I think about it in terms of how can I serve my family? How can I serve my community? How can I help others? When I look at my time coming to church, is it, well, what am I going to get out of this? What is the church going to do for me today? Or is it more in terms of what can I do to serve my brothers and sisters in Christ around me? How can I help others? How can I build them up? How can I encourage them? When it comes to what I decide to do, do I make my decision knowing clear well that it is not in line with God's will? But you know what? God just has to be okay with the choices I am making because it is my life and what I want to do. Every single one of these attitudes comes back to the same selfishness and, in fact, greed of the same tenant farmers. If that is my attitude of life, if this is all about me, what I get out of it, what I'm going to do for myself, what I want to do regardless of what God says, then what awaits me? The same thing that Jesus said. That if it's all about me, all about what I want to get out of it, all of what I am going to do, regardless of what God says, well, then I should expect the same thing, that the owner of this vineyard, that God the Father would come and judge me. That he would come and destroy me the way he destroyed those tenant farmers. Because that's just right and fair. To take everything that God has given to us, everything from the possessions we own to the people he has put into our lives, to everything about us. He gave it all. Are we using it just purely for ourselves, or are we using it to glorify God? You know, Jesus tells this story, and it's a parable of judgment. And the people got the message. The people, may this never be. We never want to see this kind of judgment happen. We don't want to see death and destruction rain down upon us. Even if it is justified, even if it is the right thing to do, we don't want the judgment. May this never be. But is there anything good to get out of this at the same time? Well, amazingly, it comes in the fact right after it says that the owner will kill those tenants. May that never be, but it goes on to say, and he will give the vineyard to others. Now, if you were this owner of the vineyard, you had just rented out some tenants, and the tenants had not once, not twice, but three times, when you had sent to go and get your crop, had mistreated and wounded and hurt your servants and sent them away empty-handed, I'm pretty sure you wouldn't just keep sending more servants there in hopes that maybe one day they would give up what actually belongs to you. But the patience is so great of the landowner, of God the Father, that he sends his beloved Son. Surely they'll respect him. They wouldn't harm him. They wouldn't treat him like they had my servants. Instead, they kill him. And you'd think after that point, when the landowner comes and he kills those tenants, he would probably destroy that vineyard, board it off, and say, you know what? I am done with this business plan, this business model. This doesn't work. I'm done with this. But instead, knowing full well, the same thing can happen again. That other people could reject him, he still gives the vineyard to others. He rents it out again, gives it to more people to work, to produce. Why? Because in the end, the rejection of the people cannot stop God and his purpose. In fact, that's what Jesus gets to. That's why he asks that question. He talks about this, and they say, may this never be. And he brings up a quote from Psalm 118. The stone the builders rejected has become the capstone. Reject Jesus, reject him, reject that son. And guess what? His building still gets built. Kill him. And he still accomplishes his purpose. You can't stop it. In fact, if you go against it, if you go against God's Son and go against Jesus, the outcome is to your detriment. That the cornerstone will break you to pieces. It will fall on you and crush you because you can't stop God from completing his mission and completing his plan. You see, that very hour, the chief priests, the teachers of the law, they wanted to arrest Jesus. This was Tuesday of Holy Week, and it would happen just 2 days from then. Jesus would let them come while he was in the Garden of Gethsemane. He would submit to them. He would let them break their own laws so that they could bind him and bring him away, falsely accuse him, put him on trial, and execute him within less than 24 hours. They would kill the Father's beloved Son. But that didn't stop the mission for which Christ had come. No, his building still got built because he is the cornerstone. He is the foundation of the entire body of believers, of the entire Christian church, that based on his life, his righteousness, everything he had done, and then giving himself up, sacrificing himself into death, this established the righteousness and perfection that we needed to stand before God. Because we are greedy. We are selfish. We're prone to these things. We give in to these things. And yes, sometimes we even reject God, telling him, hey God, I'm just going to do what I want to do. And you're just going to have to be okay with it. But that's exactly why Jesus came. And no amount of selfishness, no amount of greed, no amount of violence was going to stop him from completing that mission. Instead, we know on the third day he rose from the dead, and so he was set up. He was declared as that cornerstone, as that foundation for our holiness, for our righteousness, that he did it for us in our place. And we build upon that. Because God has given his vineyard to others, and that's us. Anyone who believes in his Son has been made a worker in that vineyard. I mean, everything we have comes from God. To just our very life, to the things we have, the people we know, all of that comes from God. And he says, work the vineyard. So how are we doing that? How are we working the vineyard? Are we working it to our glory or to his glory? And what I get to see so often is the works done to his glory. To think about just the things in the last few days, last couple of weeks, just the very fact that you're here. That you're here, and if you take a moment and say hello to somebody to encourage them. You are working that vineyard. You are serving as a part of God's people, His church, built on His foundation. That as you came maybe yesterday on Saturday, you helped clean up the church, that you did that for God's glory. That as you've been bringing food on the Wednesday night potlucks before our service, that you're helping nourishing the bodies of your fellow believers and enjoying that fellowship. You are serving God by serving others. And that even as you have today, and you know that's in the bulletins, you know, our invites, our postcards, our intentional outreach into our community to say, hey, we want you to know about Christ. We want you to know about the one on whom my entire life stands. That without him being who he is, my perfect Savior, the one who lived all of this for me and died on the cross, I'm complete. I'm whole. And I want you to come know that. That's why we give you, and I know you use these and give them out to other people. You put them up at home, or you put them up at your cubicle at work, and you show people, this is the Savior I want you to know, because I'm working for Him. Because it's all to His glory that I am who I am. And it's all to His glory that I am saved. So I want you to know Him, and I want you to know what I know, because may it never be that you fall into the hands of God's judgment. Because it was right. It was right for him to go, and in the parable, for the owner of the vineyard to kill those tenant farmers for killing his son. But may this never be. May instead he build us up on Christ, who is our cornerstone. That he wipes out of us our selfishness and our greed to instead work to his praise and glory. Knowing that he will always stand, his works, his life, his righteousness. That we would build on him and work for his glory, bringing others to that same building, that body of the holy Christian church who has their foundation on Christ. Amen. Please stand. The peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and minds through faith in Christ Jesus. Amen. Let's continue with the Apostles' Creed. You find that on page 8 in our worship folder. Living together in trust and hope, we confess our faith.
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From there he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
You may be seated. Just a note to our guests and visitors who are with us today, it's a pleasure to have you, a pleasure to share Christ as our cornerstone, everything for our perfection and our salvation. If you'd like to know more about what we teach, preach, and believe here at Layton Valley, there are contact cards in the racks in every second and fourth chair. You put your name on that, whatever contact information you'd like me to use so I can get a hold of you this following week. You can put that in the offering plate as it comes around, or you can hand it to me at the end of the service today. So that in mind, let's gather our gifts and offerings in worship to our Lord. Thank you. Please stand for prayer. As we have been for the season of Lent, during the prayer of the church, I'll end each petition with the phrase, God of mercy, and we'll all respond, hear our prayer. In this season of repentance and healing, we accept God's call to be mindful of the needs of others, offering our prayers on behalf of those in God's church and world. Heavenly Father, through your Son, you have done a new thing that leaves your church astonished in praise and adoration, even through rejection. But even through that rejection, you accomplish our salvation. You sent your beloved Son into this world in order to be our righteousness and to bestow on us, who only deserve to be cast out, his own eternal inheritance. For this we give you glory and praise. God of mercy,
hear our prayer.
Bestow your Spirit, we pray, on all the ministers of the gospel, especially to our Synod President, our District President, and all missionaries and servants of the Church, that they be given grace to only ever build on Christ, our cornerstone. God of mercy,
hear our prayer.
Kind Father, remember in your compassion this family of your children. Fill us with your joy in these Lenten days, and make us strong witnesses to your Son's death and resurrection for the world's salvation. God of mercy,
hear our prayer.
King of all, you hold in your hand all the powers that exist throughout the world. We commend to you all the public servants of our nation, all who make, judge, and enforce our laws, and all those who serve in our armed forces. Make them a blessing of yours, and strengthen and uphold them in every good deed. God of mercy,
hear our prayer.
Lover of the human race, remember all who call upon you in their hour of need. The sick, the suffering, the persecuted, the dying, the grieving, and especially all for whom our prayers are desired. We pray particularly today for our brothers in Christ, for Larry Hendrickson, as he's in the hospital and his stomach, his intestines are not working the way that you have designed them to. Grant him healing and relief, Lord. Restore him so that he can return home and continue to serve you. Also, we pray for our brother in Christ, Ron Hugh Miller, as his kidneys are not functioning in the way that they should. Through the doctors, through the treatments that they have prescribed, bring healing to his body, all according to your will. May your holy angels attend Ron, Larry, and all those who suffer with the sweet promises of your word to strengthen them and granting them relief, knowing that you know how to best answer our prayers. God of mercy,
hear our prayer.
Bountiful giver of every blessing, we rejoice to give you thanks for your great mercies to us. Day by day, without any merit or worthiness in us, your good gifts shower down upon us. To you we give all praise in union with Christ, our Lord. God of mercy,
hear our prayer.
Now hear us, Lord, as we bring you our private petitions. God of mercy,
hear our prayer.
All these things, what else you see that we need, grant us, O God, for the sake of Christ, who died and rose again, and now lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen.
And we pray the prayer that you have taught us.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever.
Amen.
Our Lord Jesus Christ, the night he was betrayed, took bread. When he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, Take and eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. Same way, he also took the cup. After giving thanks, he gave it to them, saying, Drink from it, all of you. "This is my blood of the new covenant, which is poured out for you for the forgiveness of your sins. Do this, whenever you drink it, in remembrance of me. The peace of the Lord be with you always."
Amen.
So if you have questions about this practice, please speak with me after service today, because I'd love to share with you all that God has done for us. Also, we have the refrain for Take and Eat printed in there that will be played on CD. Feel free to just meditate upon those words or sing along with the refrain as the hymn is played. And with that, the ushers will guide you up, coming down the side aisles to the center and then going back to your seat through the center aisle. God bless your communion.
Thank you.
preserve you until life everlasting. Depart in peace and in joy. Your sins are forgiven. Amen.
Thank you.
Please stand. We'll continue with the Song of Simeon as you find at the top of page 12 in our worship folder. Then that is when the judgment comes, we know he will declare us not guilty. As far as announcements, first of all, hopefully you all had in your worship folder one of our postcards. These just came out. I got mine in my mailbox on Friday. So they've gone out to the community around the church. But this is for you to use personally, your personal invites to the people you know, the people who are in your lives. You can, of course, hand deliver it. You can put a stamp on it and mail it out. However, you would be able to use this to invite people to come and hear about Christ, especially on a Good Friday service, to hear that most wonderful expression of love that culminates in sending His Son as our atoning sacrifice. So that, and also we're going to use these again come Saturday, starting at 9 a.m. We'll meet here at the church for a little bit of training, and then we're going to go out into a neighborhood and try to have some of these conversations and invite people to come for our Good Friday and Easter services. So we'd love to have any and every one of you join us for that. And then you can see what's going on. There's lots of things happening here in April, so I'll leave those announcements to you. Our last Wednesday night service is going to be this Wednesday. I will have Pastor Peel from Prince of Peace coming in. Again, we'll have our potluck starting at 5:45 p.m., and then we will have service at 7 p.m. before next Sunday, which is Palm Sunday, and that starts our Holy Week worship. Okay, Erica?
Something that's not in the bulletin is we'll be doing an Easter egg hunt for the children after breakfast on Easter Sunday.
So yeah, we just added that. So, like I said, lots of stuff happening in April, so Easter egg hunt after breakfast, Erica?
Yes.
Yeah, after breakfast. So about 9:45. 10 o'clock-ish before worship. So yeah, bring some kiddos to that. With that, I'll leave the rest of the announcements to you, and I'll get to the back to shake your hand, say hello to the people you worship with today, maybe someone you haven't said hello to yet, and then feel free to come over to the fellowship hall, grab some goodies, and God bless you this week.